not sure where to stand. So about a year ago, in lieu of kind of in a way of introducing the topic this morning, which is the campus master plan, I wanted to step back. About a year ago, we were finishing up the strategic plan. We got a lot of input from all the faculty, all the Highlands community into our plan. And one of the main things that came out of the plan was what is called strategic priority three, which is campus and facilities. And so, unfortunately, I can't read this nearly. But what we do at Highlands, obviously the most important thing we do, the school does, is educate our kids in 21st century learning. So one of the objectives is to have a comprehensive look at our facilities, our campus, our buildings, and see how we should best have, how our campus can best function to fulfill that mission. So a couple of the objectives, updating classrooms and learning spaces that enable 21st century learning, facilities to support our commitment to nutrition and wellness, appropriate facilities for early childhood education, and multi-purpose spaces to accommodate extracurricular and after-school activities. So a couple of the strategies to fulfill those objectives are to develop a campus plan to address these issues and to begin campus improvements as determined by the plan. So this master planning process started
February a year ago.
Yeah. So under a committee led by Linus Perkins and other members, the committee are myself, John Michael Bodner, who's a board member, Bart Stevens, who's a board member, Randall Miner, board member, and then Kavita Sill, Jennifer Dillon, Robert McGee, Larry Bender, Bruce Lanier, who's a parent and an architect, and Anthony Stevens, who's a parent and has an architectural background as well. So right now, we're at the point where the plan is still, it has taken some shape, but it's still in, it's still moving. It's still getting input. It's still going to need massage and thought and refinement. And so Architecture Works was the group that we hired to lead this campus master plan creation. And I think, as you'll hear today from them, the process that they've gone through is a critical process of gathering input, gathering data, putting that into a plan. And so to present this morning from Architecture Works is Jay Pickford, Will McGarity, and Marzette Fisher. And they have a lot of educational design experience with Altamont, with Springs, and with Creighton Montessori, and perhaps others, but so we're gonna, they're gonna present where we are, and then we'll have some time for some Q&A. So take it away.
All right, thanks, Jim. This has been a great process. We've had a lot of wonderful input from stakeholders along the way, and we are still, I would say, in the midst of the kind of explorations of possibilities of the master plan. So this is, this forum right here and the follow-up from this are really critical to still informing the opportunities for the master plan. So take that as a charge to y'all to be critical about it and to still give more input. When we started the master plan process, we want to look at opportunities of the campus and those that reinforce the strengths that you already have in place and capitalize on those. And these are just some images of the schools that actually Jim just mentioned that Marzette, Will, and myself have all been directly involved in. Marzette led the Indian Springs project, and it's really transformed their campus. If you haven't been out there, I highly recommend you go out there. I'm partial to Altamont, of course, because I'm along there, so I can't push it too much. But we kind of straddle the fence there, those two schools. But it is a wonderful project. We're very proud of it. It created great gathering spaces. It's all about their kind of open, more collegiate campus. And it was very intentional about engaging the lake out there, so all these buildings begin to face the lake. Altamont, also a very transformational project, the Fine Arts Center there. transformed the gymnasium space into a true theater space. So it's really capitalizing on existing infrastructure, much like we look at here at y'all's campus. There are a lot of opportunities to improve what's already here. There are also, you know, we have to take a hard look at, do we really want to spend the money to save a building that's pretty far down the road? And then Farm Lab is another kind of educational aspect project that Will's been involved in. And it's really about creating entry, creating a space, a place outside. How do you begin to create classrooms that still engage the school every day that aren't actual classrooms? So new entry at Cray Montessori, and that's getting a full, they've just torn down the building there, building a new preschool building for them. And this piece is already in place there, so you can drive by and see that over in Homewood. But these are just some examples of how we look particularly at each individual client and try and reinforce what they already have and create, also kind of transform into new possibilities. Our process started in January. We're right at a year. And it always starts with kind of a discovery. We're a sponge on the front end. We come in, try to learn as much as we can, and kind of drink from a fire hose from y'all. So we spent a few days on campus, seeing we wanted to do that before school let out. So we did that in February and then also in May. And really just trying to understand the flow of the campus, how the buildings work, how the students use them, how the administration uses them, how the parents use them. So we were here at drop-off and pick-up, all those kind of components. You know, nosing around the campus throughout the day to find those hidden gems that some, a lot of people know about, some people don't know about. How can we capitalize on those? Again, it's all about, it's just trying to understand, and we won't have a complete understanding even when we're done. I mean, it's a very complex place. Y'all have an incredible community here that we saw in all the surveys. So we're just trying to, you know, take all that information and overlay it on the master plan and make sure we're reinforcing what's important to you. We want to support your strategic plan, and Jim's already gone over the objectives that are in the strategic plan. And there are other things that came out of stakeholder input that will also fold on top of those objectives. We always want to come back to the strategic plan and are we reinforcing those? Are these decisions we're making about master plan giving the tools you need to support the curriculum that you endeavor to provide? So we had a lot of stakeholder input. We had input from administration, from staff, from students, from parents, all in different forms. The administration, we had a couple of meetings with that were very focused. To talk, and really this is trying to get at the needs of the campus. What are the needs of the campus? What works really well? What doesn't work really well? The staff, we had a staff retreat at our office, and that's what these images are all from. We did a number of kind of work sessions throughout the morning. One was looking at, you know, inspiring pictures of other schools, other things that other people have done, that, and some that we've done. What do you like about it? What do you not like about it? What inspires you? What excites you? It's really starting to broaden your vision beyond this campus of what other people are doing. We always look at precedents. We always look at schools across the country that work really well, and we look at what didn't work very well. From out of that, we gained really great information about the prioritized needs that they see, that the administration staff see are needed on campus. We also had some student input through the teachers here, each classroom, first through eighth, you know, they did a little survey, and they gave us a list of, you know, what are all the, where all the things off, I don't remember some of them, I can't remember them all, but they're sent like a helipad, things like that, you know, great things like that, that they know we'll implement, no problem. Yeah, the zoo, there was a zoo, yeah. More animals was a big thing. I don't know if John Michael's pushing that. Probably big. So that, it's always great to read that, but you also get real things like bathrooms, like where do I put my book bag? Where do I, you know, the pragmatic things that have, sometimes fall by the wayside that you forget about because you're trying to get a new front door and you don't realize that, you know, you need more room between the car and the front door. So it's very eye-opening to get their perspective. And then, of course, we had the parent survey that hopefully all of y'all responded to. We had, out of, I think, 200, we had 100 responses, which is actually an excellent response rate, and all of them were incredibly positive. And this is kind of the second piece to that, this forum, this town hall, to have a follow-up, to show you where we've kind of worked on things and to get your feedback based. We've also met with the campus facility committee. Jim outlined those members. We've met with them regularly, and we've been in touch with Linus Lockstep the whole way in Covina. So I think we've talked to them probably once every 2 weeks, maybe once a week. There have been a number of things that we've been working through with them. So it's been a great process and a very in-depth one. So this slide represents these four constituencies of input: the students, staff, admin, and parents. And I know you can't read these, but the next slide you'll be able to read them a little better. But what these begin to represent, this doesn't represent every comment that was made. What this represents is the prevalency of the comments, the prioritization, like in the staff retreat, we had asked them to prioritize needs. So this begins to kind of formulate not only what is the true scope of what we need to focus on, but also which ones may be more important than another one. It doesn't mean that we'll only focus on one thing for the master plan. Our goal is to kind of encapsulate much of this in a master plan strategy, but to help you prioritize, you know, based on a phasing, or, you know, this is more important right now, and in 5 years you can work on this, those kinds of ideas down the road. So all these are taken obviously individually through these input sessions, and then we take all that and stack it on top of each other. So These are corresponding, you can see these are lining up, these are lining up, and when you stack them together, it tells a pretty clear story of critical needs. So flexible spaces, furnishings, gym multi-use spaces, the kitchen lunchroom, you know, these become, they're recurring themes amongst all the constituencies. We do have, you know, things at the end. Spencer Center, we love the Spencer Center, get updated, but it doesn't have the telling story that maybe outdoor spaces does, or the family center. This doesn't mean that, you know, we're only going to build, maybe recommend building a gym building. Really, it tells us priority section. Helps us to, you know, this is coming from y'all, from the staff, from the students, and helping to guide us as we begin to explore options on the master plan. Coupled with that, the school, Tavita and her staff have taken some school visits to Duke School, Trinity, Westminster, and there's another plan to go to New Orleans. And really in Memphis, and these are critical trips not only to explore curriculum ideas, but also to explore, this is very timely because it's just for, you know, what have they done with their facilities? How are they carrying their facilities? What works for them? What doesn't? You know, what common spaces are great? What's not great about this space? You know, what tinker spaces they've done? How common is that idea? It's very common. And that's not an unknown thing to us, but it's neat to see, you know, how they actually create these. And it's very similar to how you all created one here, this STEM lab here, in that they've taken an existing space and reimagined it. So those are really the compelling things we want to focus on. How do classrooms, you know, get a great connection to the exterior, great playgrounds, you know, all these pragmatic issues that every school deals with that some deal better than others. This is very important input into this process as well. So all these begin to layer on top of each other and inform one another. The last not the last in importance, but just the final piece of this puzzle is what's existing on your site right now. This represents a programming kind of layout of your campus right now. So we're sitting in Spencer Center here, your existing gym, the field, the rear drop-off, the front drop-off, the library and admin here, early education here, and then the lower and middle school here. So we look at this really to give us a roadmap of where we're starting from. It helps to, you know, you begin to see, you know, where the concentration of big functions are on campus, big events. So you have this connection of big events with this parking back here. There's some synergy there, the soccer, all those pieces. Then you have the classrooms up here focused on the quad. It's really this discovery, and then overlaid on that is your existing utility infrastructure. Now, not to say that a lot of these utilities can't move around, and in Indian Springs they moved, at CMS they moved, but there are certain pieces you don't want to take an investment that you've already made in. This green line right here represents a sewer line with an easement, and you don't want to spend more money after that one. You want to try and capitalize on some existing infrastructure here and not totally rejigger the entire campus, because there's not a need to. It's a great campus. You've got a great focus of the quad. You've got incredible natural surrounding around the buildings that we want to take advantage of, more so than we already are. So how can the buildings engage those and not disrupt a lot of the money that you already have in place? So we typically will go through about, you know, 40, 50, 60 just sketch iterations of master plans as we progress through, and even the committee hasn't seen everything we've kind of poured through. But these represent some iterations of the campus re-envisioning in a master plan format that really just begin to talk about a process, and you're not intended to really be able to kind of make out every little room or how you get from one place to the other. It's more about adjacencies. If the gymnasium stays here, it makes some synergy with the soccer field, but whether it goes this way or whether it turns, how the play area, you know, relates to that. There are certain buildings that are really good infrastructure right now, although they may need updating, like the Spencer Center, like the Steislinger Center. And then there are other buildings that, like the gymnasium and like this the lower middle school building, that are really beyond their time. The way they function, just the life that they've lived are kind of, they've had a good life. It's time to say, let them float on down the river. But you also have great opportunities to engage more of a quad space to possibly, you know, create a lunchroom that also extends out into the quad. So we explore all these kind of ideas. Do we do a two-story building? Do we keep the existing lower middle school there and re-envision it into this, add on to it, update it? So we really work through all these, and we still, as we mentioned, we're still working through a lot of them. And this is kind of where we're most current right now. So I want to kind of walk through this with y'all. It really, and it's got some main points to it. One is creating a main entry here, an entry that can accommodate the scale of the school y'all are now. It's not a single hallway. You know, you need a space that you can control securely, but also that a large amount of people can move through, and also that put them into, you know, that they can move through here and put them into a space, your probably most precious, I would call, space, which is the quad, which connects all the buildings together, also gives the freedom of the children to move through that. All these things that reinforce of what Highlands is really about. That coupled with track, really engaging the classrooms with outdoor space directly, having an interior connection, but also giving opportunities that kids can move in and out of those classrooms freely, but in a controlled environment. Creating spaces amongst the classrooms scattered through the campus that are these green pieces that might be these tinker spaces or these flex spaces that, so you don't have just one of those, you have one for maybe every grade level, potentially. You have a possibility of connecting to the back, the hillside here, the natural outdoor area, and maybe a community space on the backside of the building that really begins to engage both sides of the campus. A gymnasium that can engage a play area, but also be a part of this whole soccer field. Could also create some kind of outdoor experience between these two buildings, which really all your major events are, your big community-wide events are happening amongst these buildings here. A lot of times the school-wide events happen here during the school year, but having a lunchroom cafeteria that can open and engage into the quad area outside there. So it's really, it's beginning to explore opportunities where these spaces extend well beyond their walls. The Spencer Center, maybe expanding the arts facility is an opportunity as well. Connecting the family center into the preschool building as a potential expansion opportunity. Now the cafeteria is over here, you have a full kind of lunchroom. Maybe this is a two-story building, so it could get built in phase. Ahead of this building coming down, you can see the existing building there, the existing gymnasium dashed, so that you have classrooms in place that students can move immediately into, and then you tear the other building down and build a new building there, potentially. Again, all these are still, really explorations right now, and they need further input and further thought. What about this? The zoo, yeah. The zoo, you just get on this road. So that, it's really trying to engage this quad more intentionally with the classrooms and buildings that surround it. And this shows kind of a kind of expansion of the quad. But also, you know, we need to create some kind of more formal entry as you move from this side of campus. This is a very important entrance. It's really been neglected over time. This is an important entrance to this building. So how can we reimagine that? Maybe we're creating an entrance here, and you move into this building here, and then this is more just, you know, classroom art spaces, and you have a true kind of lobby space for this space. You don't walk directly into the space. So these are all, and I know I'm kind of pouring fire hose at you right now, but these are kind of the ideas that we're working through at the moment. And I open it up to any questions, thoughts, yeah.
Sorry, Jay, also there was the potential that you thought about maybe putting in a teaching on that side.
Yeah, so the other space is kind of a leftover space. It's the space between the parking lot and the field. You kind of move down through to get to the field. And how can we use that space differently? And maybe a great opportunity for a teaching garden. And you could have, you know, kind of tiered sections there where you could have some, and maybe even structures there that allow for student groups to come out there, work in the garden. It also puts that garden really in the forethought, you know, in the front of vision of everyone that moves through the campus. So instead of having it more tucked away, what we try to do, especially at these farm labs for the city schools, is to put these outdoor learning spaces right in the middle of things. So the kids are, you know, used to going to them. It's not like they're afraid to go to them, but they're not kind of hold off to one side. They're put right into kind of the front mat. So at those places, we put them at playing fields, so the kids are always in and around them. They're encouraged to go into them, work in them. So that's the idea of that space there, to capitalize on that space that's just sitting there waiting for something to happen.
One of the things that was the most used in flex space, would you highlight up here with?
Yeah, so this lunchroom and cafeteria is really, I would call more of a, this kind of multi-use space that could take on a number of functions. I mean, you have lunch for an hour and a half a day, and then what happens with it the rest of the time? Well, EDP can happen in it. All sorts of activities can happen in it. You know, classrooms getting together, three or four, maybe two grade levels getting together in it. That's a real great space. You have events in there that pour out onto a porch that opens out into the quad. So that's one space. The gym obviously is a big flexible space that you're already kind of using that way right now in different ways. And then we have these smaller kind of these tinker flex spaces that are scattered really more through the building. We have a few here. You know, in the lower school, it's not quite as important that it be associated directly with the classroom, but you need these kind of after school guitar and language speech spaces. So that after school component can still use spaces in this building. And then the lower and middle school would have spaces directly connected to their classrooms. So there's a as you get older, there's a little bit more freedom. You know, the kids can move independently to these spaces as they want to.
Hey Jay, would you read with the colors?
Yelp
anymore?
It doesn't focus anymore. That's part of the master plan. The yellow is administration. So there are a few places where administration, this is kind of an idea of a real entry lobby for the early education for the family center. So yellow is administration, and the idea is to wrap administration around the front to give them a presence across the entire front of this building. And since we're envisioning rerouting all the kind of circulation, instead of going directly through the heart of the building, putting it to an edge so that you're either circulating outside or inside. So the gray is kind of circulation space. The red are all classroom spaces, whether they're arts or language or just regular classrooms. The blue are support, kind of restroom and support spaces. The green are the kind of multi-use space. So the library we see is a multi-use space that y'all are using in that way. But and creating more kind of smaller, you really want to have a variety of scales of multi-use space. Right now you've got a library or you've got an office. And what we need are kind of the in-between spaces that you can gather different scale groups. And then we have this lighter blue is really like locker room stuff, service, bare rooms, mechanical rooms, things like that. Yes?
So what are you thinking about parking? I'm not seeing any additional parking here.
So the thought about parking is to, and we didn't show it in the idea for parking is really to look at opportunities along your existing parking to make it more efficient, but also to maybe expand. Like here, where you've got a double row here, you've got a single row there, and there's probably an opportunity to add parking along that edge, even though there's drop-off and everything there. I think there's a real opportunity there. There's an opportunity along this edge, honestly, to add more. You're already doing that in a way when you have events, is parking along here, along this two lane, and making it just into one way, which is very smart. I mean,
we can pick up about 20 cars if we restripe this lot and make it one way, which is really the way it functions anyway, if you go around that block counterclockwise. And I think, well, we picked up 20, 25 spaces. So just a little, and not repaint anything. So, there's some efficiencies that can be gained within the format that you currently have.
I mean, what we when you're on a campus like this where you're very tight on space and you also don't want to decimate what you've got, which is a real asset, which is surrounding the property, which is this nice buffer, this natural buffer. We would argue that three times a year, it's very inconvenient. It sucks. And you've got to park offside or whatever. I mean, Altamont deals with it. Craig Montessori deals with it. I mean, that all of that, you're not alone in this issue of parking. But our feeling is that let's not try and solve that thing that happens very infrequently on campus. Let's focus on the things that happen that affect people every single day. You've got a great scenario to drop off. I mean, it works like a dream, I promise you. It seems like you're sitting in line forever, but you're not. Compared to Altamont or compared to CMS, you're just not. You've got the split, which is brilliant, and it's very efficient how it's managed. So really, we have not focused on parking per se. We want to incorporate some opportunities there for additional parking, but we don't want to try and solve 300 cars on the site. I don't think. I think we'd spend a lot of money and not really get a lot of payback for it.
I'm glad you're not touching my woods.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this trail is, I didn't touch on the trail, but this trail is an incredible asset that you have right now that could be, with very little money, could really be brought up to the next level of opportunity for the kids to move around the campus. Go ahead.
So right now I think that student capacity at the school is like just over 300 or so. What size student body is this potentially?
We targeted Yeah, 350 to 375. And what are we right now?
And the 375 is family center through day.
Yes.
Yeah. 15 years ago or so, the master plan was 325 when we threw all this. The what's the square footage estimate for these renovations that you're proposing or as part of this?
The size?
Yes, it looks like it's about 30 and 35.
Yeah, I think that's close. 35,000. I don't know that it will come up with the exact number here in a second, but yeah, it's near that. I mean, again, this is not, and I should have said this on the front, this is not an intention to, although it does have a lot of detail here, this is more trying to allocate space and adjacencies more than this is exactly the configuration of the building. So it's going to ebb and flow some as the next, when you get, the master plan is a roadmap. And beyond that, you then decide, you know, which direction do we want to go with the first step of this roadmap. And once you do that, then you really hone in on, okay, what is that exactly, and how can we tighten it to make it efficient, but also give us the right amount of space. So to say a number, right, do we know?
Well, it's about 25 in the new building, but it's also increasing classrooms to 19 classrooms.
From 16?
So it's additional classrooms, and then it's all multi-use space. Is that also can function as a space?
But the 25, that is 17, that's 20. Okay. So it's about, it's right at 30, call it 30.
30,000 square feet of new space.
Yeah.
And maybe remodel of 25,000?
I don't know that it's necessarily a very, it doesn't have to be a very invasive remodel of the other buildings. Like, we're showing a major remodel of these buildings. You know, this is a kind of a 20-year look at this thing. And so I think you could do some pretty minimal updating to the buildings and
repurpose.
Yeah, and repurpose what's there, keep the walls in place of the classrooms intact, unless there's a big need to change things right at this moment. Sorry for the shoes, Eddie. Go ahead.
Is the new multifunctional dining area going to be able to accommodate all 375 students all at one sitting, or is it still?
No. The idea is that you have probably two turns, probably three turns in that dining hall. So you don't build something for 300, which would be about this right here. That and the, I think that we're putting 200 in that, just under 200 in that space. Yeah, 150 to 200, yeah. So it accommodates, sounds like it's about half the school.
So they take away that there will be two waves of students having.
Well, that's it's really I don't know how the actual lunchroom circulation will happen in terms of how many, you know, you want grades to go together. So there's a sequence right now how it happens. begin to not separate them, but to give them their own identity, their own home, their place to be, and not, you know, have an eighth grader run into a first grader as they're trying to get a class or something like that.
There are economies associated with it as well in terms of the size of the seating space for dining. If you want to get the entire student body together, the gym is available, which the gym will take on more of a multi-purpose role. And the size of the kitchen is driven by the number of seats that you have. So there's some economies there as well, in addition to the administrative requirements of how you stratify the ages.
But here, I think a lot of the time also is just the efficiency of how can we make this a more central place for the entire school. Keepers. How can we help that timing you're talking about with not only the delivery of the food in the dining hall, but also just where it is on campus, where it delivers?
Who do you see the transition to something like this looking like? Is this over 3 summers or something like that, or do we do this construction during the school year? Or?
I think we're still kind of exploring the schedule and how it could happen. I'll just mention that I think you could potentially build, you know, if you wanted to look at a phasing, if you looked at it all together, the sequence is probably, you have this existing classroom building that you don't want to tear down until you've got some other classrooms built, if you can do that. So maybe building this building first, which would afford you some classrooms there, and then reducing that building and creating this second building. You know, in terms of a overall time frame of construction, we'd really want to get with a contractor to inform that a bit. And, you know, this is still being explored, you know, there's still a lot of components that are moving around, it's not a year.
Here's the thing about all this is that it's expensive. I don't know what it's going to cost, but it's very expensive. And so part of the next steps of this plan is what can we actually raise? How much money can we raise? And so next steps for the strategic plan and the campus plan is a feasibility study. What can we feasibly expect that we can raise if we were to go to a capital campaign? So, and that's assuming that once we get through this plan that we, let me put it this way. Our feasibility study will have a big impact on how we attack this. We have to kind of work through that. So what we'll do is at the end of this, we're going to post this plan on the website. And we're going to send out, I'm not sure how we're sending it out yet, but a survey for input on this plan so people can take a look at it and get back. So there's that next step also. And then a feasibility study, and then putting some more thought and work into the plan and taking the plan actually to some potential donors and say, you know, what do you think? Because a lot of that going to inform what we can or cannot do. So there's a lot of steps that are going to take place before we can come, I think, to a decision about how this happens.
Yeah. It'll still be shaped by these subsequent steps. So when this goes online today, it's not the end-all be-all. It's really just to gain input, and as a feasibility study will also gain input. I mean, at CMS, we went this master plan, this same kind of similar process, came to master plan, went to feasibility study. It informs a certain scale of fundraising, and some donors had very specific ideas about what they wanted to give to, which is very important. And so that informed a rework a little bit of the master plan. So it's a very fluid, it's a living document. I mean, this master plan document is not this is it, do not deviate from this. You know, it's more of a, it's like your strategic plan. It'll be updated over time and informed at every step of the way.
Likewise, in Indian Springs, I don't think they would mind me sharing this with you, but we developed a master plan, went through this process with them, and ended up with three phases. Phase one was classrooms. Phase two was an arts building, and phase three was a dining hall. And then during the process, phases two and three got superimposed on each other. Phase two is now the dining hall. They just finished the classrooms. Basically, as Jim aptly points out, they're trying to recover and make sure that they've got all the stitches in their financial wallet from being damaged with the fundraising. But they're taking a deep breath and looking at phase two now, which is the dining hall. And they're in a similar situation, but maybe from a different perspective. Their dining hall is 60 years old, and it looks every bit of 60 years old. So now they have brand new classrooms that are, let's just call it state-of-the-art. So they're looking at what they want to do for phase two. And also there is a parental cohort that takes on the responsibility of phases, if you will. Meaning phase one is our job. We'll take care of that. We'll hand the baton to the next cohort, and then they'll deal with phase two. So as Jay points out, the master plan is actually just a roadmap that outlines areas, adjacencies, tries to break it down into how phases could logically be built from a construction and financing standpoint. And then, as Jim pointed out, you've got the fundraising component that has to follow with that. And ideally, the administration, meaning Comita, would use the master plan as sort of a thing that she pulls off the shelf periodically and reports back to the parent group as to where things are, and then you decide where you want to go with it.
I might just say in reaction to that, what would be great before you commence your feasibility study is for you guys to componentize as much as you can into phases, so that if you were doing a feasibility study, if you tell me, we think logically in the order of construction, in the order of priority, whatever it is, the most bang for the buck, we think phase one might be the following, and we estimate phase one might cost this. So for this amount of money, you're gonna get this, and then phase two is this, and the whole thing is this, and that's really what you're, in a feasibility study, you're asking people,
absolutely,
can I raise this amount for phase one, or two, or three, or do it all, or do how much of it can I do?
Yeah.
That way, when you're asking a donor, they have some specific idea what you get for your money.
You're absolutely right.
Two questions.
First, really saying, as a parent of Indian Springs too, it's, you know, looking at these boxes, those type boxes, seeing what you guys did out there, you know, great compliments, because even when you're indoors, you feel like you're in a classroom, it's in nature, or outdoors, and so it's hard to kind of get that from, you know, conventional boxes.
Sure.
It's really, you guys did a great job there.
Thank you.
Even with the classrooms there, it's just really remarkably different, you know, and that's probably what my boxes would be from up here. It's a real different set.
Yeah.
My question is, and I don't, it's based on an assumption that may be wrong, but it's my understanding is that the soccer field that we have is actually too small to be regulation for the higher than like U-12. Is that correct?
Yeah, over U-12.
I think what you get. So, assuming that that would still be the case, what would be the incremental cost or size of making the gym a facility that could accommodate the same size soccer that we have now? Maybe like a ball. Because the soccer field is taking up a lot of prime expansion real estate, and the gym, and we have, you know, it seems like weather issues.
You mean an indoor facility?
Yeah, indoor facility for soccer, or a multi-purpose facility.
That's only in the field a little bit more, I think, than where it is today.
This plan assumes a U-12.
Okay, so you're actually enlarging.
No, not enlarging, no.
You're not, okay.
It's a maximum, it's the minimum size for a U-12 regulation field. It doesn't, it's roughly the same size. It provides a little bit more order to it now. The edges are, but it brings some order to the field, but it keeps that size.
You're asking, how do we accommodate these weather events and...
Well, that's one factor. It is one factor. It would be a unique thing if we had the ability to bus operators.
One opportunity is to purchase a house in the corner, and because we already own the other house, and then that road shifts over to the right, and then you have to drop the sand in that road.
Well, we've looked at that a little bit, that parcel up on the corner, and it's so...
There's not much to expect. You can definitely reroute the road around here. I don't think there's any doubt there, but there's probably not much opportunity to actually build on that property because of the nature of the topography is going up. And there may be a component down the road that is identified that can live over here unto itself, but as you can see, the campus kind of wants to all be close. You're a elementary and middle school, so you don't want to get a lot of distance between the buildings because little people can't walk that far. But it does offer some expansion of the building. You know, what I hear the soccer program asking for is we want a lot of opportunity for fields, and I don't think you're going to find that on this site.
Right.
Because you're a school. Your curriculum, you're trying to deliver a quality curriculum. And this is a component of that, but this is not the point of the spear. And so I think you want to be careful about how much emphasis you put on trying to solve that thing that I'm not sure you can really solve on this site. You can get to a level, as you all know, but it's a very complex situation of, is it really a Highlands team, or are the kids going to really just go play Vestavia anyway, or Homewood, or Busa, or whatever they're going to do? That is something that's way beyond our expertise, honestly. I mean, we're happy to look at whatever opportunities there might be, but...
And I understood. I didn't mean for the, like, Highlands.
Right. Sure.
Just the, like, I mean, we got a little gym anyway. That space, that kind of open space, is how much larger would that space then have to be to accommodate a soccer match?
Yeah.
Well, what you're talking about, Doug, is basically like a University of Alabama kind of indoor practice facility.
Or like the D1 place.
The D1 building is probably, roughly like that scale.
Okay.
It's a big,
way too big.
I think it probably will be. And I think you'll be sorry that you don't have that just outdoor experience for the kids. I mean, that field gets wet, it gets boggy at times, and we could probably work on that to amend that through drainage.
The issue that brings on, though, is really thermal comfort. If you've got a multifunction space, I mean, you're not going to air condition that space. You may ventilate it, but you're not going to air condition it. Acoustics get to be somewhat of an issue. It's a great thought, but I think in this particular application, maybe there are other priorities that resource, financial resource.
Well, yeah, and that's, well, I think the answer to my question is too big. It's a lot there.
Probably for this site, I think it is.
Okay.
Now, Mount Brook is looking at the MBST site down there, so maybe we can convince them to do some stuff down there.
You may have answered this question already, and you did the head count total, but I guess as a family center parent, how many of those new bodies and more square footage allocated spaces are for the family center? And the reason I ask is because I think there's so much potential, and this is kind of a combination question, for the family center, and those baby turn into students and then make Judy's job a lot easier. But what kind of emphasis is it going to be in that specific area? Because it looks like a little step on that.
Well, it looks that way, but the idea is that this, the opportunity of these additional classrooms over here are twofold. One is an opportunity to have some language move over here in the midst of all the classrooms, but it's also an opportunity to have the first grade move over. And now this gets into a kind of something we've touched on. It's like, I don't know if we can change that mindset or all that, but if you imagine the first grade moving over, then everybody kind of shifts down and you really open up this entire building for Family Center. So there's a huge opportunity, I think, there to give you flexibility. And maybe it's not all three classrooms, maybe you only have two classrooms and you have this kind of flexible indoor play space for the kids. I mean, something fun like that, I mean. So this connection right here is critical, I think, to make that happen and to give a real kind of entry space. That program, from what I hear, is growing. It has the potential to grow.
I think what Jay is saying is that architecturally, we can accommodate the size that you think you want to grow to that's appropriate for the balance within this environment. I know that Kavita, I think, is interested in AC accreditation for that function, if you will, on campus, which is a very positive thing. It does have certain space requirements for child and outdoor space requirements, et cetera. But with the shifting functionally of some of the classroom areas back into maybe the new volume of the screen, the facilities as they exist right now are not going to really be your limitation. I think it's going to be up to y'all to make a call.
I'd like to speak a little bit to that. So I think Robert really needs to be the people that were involved in the process. I think just from a admin faculty perspective.
Do you want a pointer?
No. I think what was really important to us is we also took a look at the history of the school and what has been done in terms of expansion. And so the last major building campaign was the cycling center. And so that is a great space, but that is already, 12-ish years old. And that has, my main thing was, what's going to have the most student impact, period, right? And so when you look at it from that point of view, the last time the school did any kind of building expansion was Cycler Center, and that had a student impact, but it was mainly the media center. And that's not a kind of space where the kids live in, all the kids live in all day, every day. They come and go and flow in and out of the library space, but it's not that much of a direct impact, and so there was much more bigger direct impact in terms of admin support and admin spaces, things like that. So I think the reason we're excited about the potential of this and whatever it's going to end up being was providing an opportunity for us to really create a student impact every day for the majority of our students. I mean, they're with us from 8 to 3, it's their home away from home. What kind of opportunity can we provide for them in terms of the type of curriculum that we want to do? 21st century learning, having flexible spaces, having spaces for staff to work together more collegially and collaboratively, which they really can't right now because of the way the spaces are done and they have a meeting space. But then also provide, like it says in the strategic plan, that student experience, right? Like, so beyond the academics, I really do consider that they're home away from home. They're with us something to do every day, so there's opportunity to really feel that in the life of the school. And as far as your question about the Family Center, we obviously see that as an opportunity for growth. So I don't want to lock us in that we're definitely going to move first grade over, but there's a lot of potential grade breakdowns that we're looking at. And one would be the possibility that if we move first grade over and made the side over this side, early childhood, which is basically birth to 5, birth to 6, that encompasses early childhood, which would mean there's opportunities then to expand Family Center full-time or even part-time programs, which I think we could do down the line, and give them that additional space and then have the other parts be more elementary and then middle school. But I guess where I was really coming from is how do we create a master campus plan that really directly impacts the students and what we want to provide them?
Okay. And it doesn't have to, you know, saying that first grade doesn't have to move over there for this expansion to have opportunity. The opportunity is right here with the lunchroom right now. So that's a big space that has a lot of capacity potential for the family center as well. So, you know, you baby steps kind of to make all that happen. Arnett?
Yeah. Just a couple questions. First is, I guess from a leadership standpoint, is there a, I guess, in the order in terms of priority that you guys would like to see, you know, as far as where we go, expansion, et cetera? And then the next question is regarding the middle school, how many are we increasing, I guess, capacity class size there? You talk about updating the building, and if we are, how does that then play into strategically increasing our retention as far as middle school size?
You may jump in on the second question. On the first part of your question, I don't think that the campus committee or the board really come to a firm direction that this is what we want phase one to be. Speaking personally, I like the idea, this is just me, this is not speaking for the board or the committee, but I like the idea of doing gym multi-use space first, because you can do that, and you can, if you can time that to get done around Christmas break, you can move kids from the middle school into those buildings, and however that class breakdown is, that disrupts campus less to me. But that's just,
and we would
just think kind of how to logistically do it the best, not necessarily what we could get the most support financially for.
Yeah, we would look very intentionally, it's kind of what you touched on, is we would look at this phasing very intentionally with respect to the school year. It's what we did at Montessori, is because they have their campus is 2.5 acres, and they're putting 200 kids on 2.5 acres. And there wasn't really a whole lot of room to just put a bunch of trailers willy-nilly all year round. Plus, they didn't want the, you know, there's a little psychology that, oh, my kids don't need a trailer. But honestly, the trailers there were much nicer. Building was there. They were like, oh, that's a lot better. But we were very intentional to only have them in trailers for half of the school year. And so in August, they'll be back in a new building. They moved into those trailers in November. So it's a very short time frame for them. Now it goes to the summer for the school and everything. But there are ways, I mean, we'll want to look very intentionally at the school calendar to abbreviate as much as possible the disruption. There will be disruption, but it's very manageable on your side. I mean, there's.
I think another thing regarding the classroom question is that there is a slight increase in area, but one thing I don't think you pointed out, Jay, is the classroom building is one level.
This classroom building is one level.
So if you look at the two-story building that it plans, it area-wise, it's only incrementally larger. Now, what is better is that there are specific spaces that are designed to support the academic activities within the classroom, the tinker spaces, the support areas, the indoor-outdoor interconnection, which is pretty cloistered in that existing building. Really can't see out very well, so it's really enhancing quality and probably incrementally a little larger in the classroom.
Yeah,
but
it's not intentioned to expand the classroom to a third more. It's really intentioned to make them more transparent to the exterior, to make them feel larger, to make these little collaborative spaces more usable, and that expands the classroom. Because it puts a few students in there every once in a while, and it just gives a lot more flexibility to those buildings.
And we learned in Springs that a dedicated space that is, quote, collaborative, or a breakout space is what we call them, it seems like it might be a little bit overkill, but it wasn't. In other words, when you've got a space that's for that, the kids get together as opposed to being in the hallways. And they go into those rooms and they get on their computers and they interact with each other, which is not classroom space, but it's sort of their own personal space that they can get into. So it's been very effective out of Springs. I would encourage you to go out and look.
So the major asset, when I think about Highlands that we have over perhaps some other independent schools, is the green space here. And I saw some wonderful images of some things that other schools are doing in terms of really enhancing and taking advantage of that green space just every day. Mm-hmm. And I think in terms of the presentation of this, emphasizing in any way, shape, or form the green space of this campus and how we are going to be taking advantage of that so that our kids, have that experience here, is just so important. And, talk about opening up the back of these classrooms and getting, what is prevalent, even on the map I'm seeing now, that's all gray. Mm-hmm. And that's not coming to life for me.
Gotcha.
And I just think that it's really...
Yeah, it's a powerful opportunity that needs to show up in this.
I think a sleeper in that regard is the garden. Meaning, if you are familiar with the little garden space outside the Emmett O'Neill Library in Mountain Brook, this could be an opportunity for...
You're talking about that or the...
No, that one. Because that's an opportunity for an unlandscaped space to take on a new character and identity, and also, more importantly, a statement about what your school is and what you want to do. The other thing about putting it up front is you can't let it get ratty. You've got to keep it up and make it a feature.
It does take investment.
You can't have the garden.
So that's another component of kind of overlay, especially the garden, is and what Jones Valley's done so brilliantly is they have placed their people in the school to manage those places. So it does take investment from a curriculum standpoint. You can't just ask each teacher to take 20 minutes out of their day to go out and work it.
Yeah.
It doesn't work. And those are things Kavita knows very well, will be a great support for that space. Yes.
My question is about the gray area along the back of those classrooms. Is that open? What?
So right
corridor, or is it part of the building?
So that's enclosed, but this is intended to all be glass here and have kind of outdoor amphitheater kind of space, or just a outdoor workspace or a gathering space of some sort. Maybe some more natural boulders and stuff. It's a pretty unbelievable, this whole edge here is just phenomenal. And I know it's like, oh my God, I don't want to go over there and play because they'll fall off the rocks, but, as we all know, risk in childhood is part of education. But it is a beautiful natural asset that if these buildings could open more to their backsides, it would be just a phenomenal, just a win-win.
But is there entry from the quad side as well?
Yes. So entries. So these are kind of the building entry points at either end of this corridor is the idea, and then these are kind of outdoor spaces off of these shared spaces. So the classrooms can open. You can get outside directly after the quad from the classrooms. You can also circulate inside if it's freezing cold. They can circulate back and forth inside. Or they can go, directly outside and get out to the quad spaces, or use that minor space right outside the classrooms. So there are a lot of different ways to, opportunities for the kids to take ownership of those spaces. Yeah.
So is the current greenhouse going to be gone?
I would say it'd be gone. It'd probably be repurposed somewhere. It's going to be. It is the idea. The current greenhouse sits right there. So, it wouldn't be just tossed away. We'd reuse it. But
where would you put that?
Well, it would be part of this teaching garden space. Yeah. So that the greenhouse, and you probably have some. You want to have some outdoor gathering that's shaded, that so you can have kind of a class presentation there or something. So at the farm labs, what we've done a lot is use this berming and some tiered seating against the berming to, you're still in this natural space, but you have a place that they can be. And it's not, every campus has this We're going to make an outdoor classroom, and it's going to be a mile away from our classroom, and we'll never get to it. I mean, what we want to make this is more accessible. Now, it's remote, but it's a part of all this outdoor activity, which is really important. That's all this wellness, this nutrition, as much as the kids are exposed and wanting to go and participate in it, is really what we're after.
I know this is way early in the process, but are there any general, like 5, 10, 20 year financial parameters, worst case, best case, you're thinking about?
In terms of the cost of the project? I don't think we've kind of got to a level that we could, we'd start to think about big picture numbers, but not broken it down to that level. And I think that's part of this whole.
My question is the big picture.
Well,
what do you mean? Like,
what's the cost?
What's the 5, 10, 20 year dream of this that you base this off of? Can you want to share that?
As far as like phasing the construction of it? If we did it, or
the cost?
Oh, the cost. Gosh, I don't know. 50 or 20 years from now, I wouldn't have a hazard guess.
Yeah, I
20 years from now,
like
if you did the gym now, like what that would cost, and then what would the new middle school building cost? Like you did that in 10 years?
No. As you approach a plan like this, are there any general parameters financially of this is about what we're thinking?
Yeah, what
when I say 5, 10, 20, I'm just matching your pages, but just in general,
people. I think we're starting to get, we haven't gotten completely, but I think we're starting to get some initial rough cost of the entire kit material. And that probably needs to be fine tuned a little bit more. And I think once we have that, then the idea would be to go to a feasibility study. Because that obviously, this is, if we end up with this, with some iterations of it, it obviously would be the dream plan. And this is sort of out of all the Delta results and everything that's come out of all the stakeholder surveys and feedback. So there is sort of this gross number that's attached to that.
We haven't refined and probably not ready to kind of put it out there.
Fair enough.
It will get out there eventually. I mean, I think in this feasibility study, that informs it a lot. And ahead of that, it's a little bit cart before the horse if you say we're going to spend X without having talked in a feasibility kind of setting with a lot of the stakeholders. Because you don't want to put the bill out before they know what they came to the table with their wall. So,
fair enough.
Yeah.
Once the scenarios get better defined, I think the point is there's probably as much as a 30 to 40% delta right now, depending on when you do it and how much of it you do. If you did the gym and the classrooms together, construction-wise, it would be the most efficient and economical for you to do it that way. I don't think in people's minds we think that will happen. So we're looking at phase, and one of the structures may be a little bit more cost-effective per square foot than the others, depending on the gym doesn't have a lot of internal walls, et cetera. So I think it's premature to be talking about any specific number now, but that's clearly one of the next steps, as the gentleman over on the other side mentioned, is that we start assigning range numbers with bases, and it's a little premature today to do that, I think. That'll be part of
like there, it will come. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank y'all so much for being here. We really appreciate it. We appreciate y'all's input. We encourage your input. I think there's going to be a follow-up email just encouraging some form of communication. From y'all directly if you have any further, but there will be kind of a brief window to allow for that.
You're going to post this to the site, so this presentation will be on your web page, so you can refer back to it.
All right, thanks, Jay. Appreciate it.